Good morning. Welcome to the Huntsville United Methodist Church, and a special welcome to any visitors we have out there. The flowers on the altar are presented in celebration of Steve Spath's birthday and are given by the family. The prayer quilt this morning is presented for Logan Wilson, and if you don't know how that works, anytime during the service, you can go tie a knot representing a prayer for him. And we'll go on to the announcements. There's a lunch with the pastor for those who are registered. Pastor B and Alice will meet up with you in the back 40 after church today. There's a youth fusion day. All youth in grades K through 12 are welcome to join us for a fusion day on Thursday, August 17th from 8:30 to 12 p.m. We're having an ice cream social at HUMC on Saturday, August 26th from 4 to 6 p.m. All proceeds from the meal are going towards the church's missions account. Sign-up sheets for donations of soda can also be found on both inner information tables. And there will also be live entertainment. And that's all that's there. So if we can turn it over to Alice. You can turn it over to Alice for her songs.
Welcome this morning to worship. Let's all stand as we begin our worship service with all the people said amen. Let's stand as we sing.
Need a mercy to be forgiven and be free. that part of the song where it says, man, we're just all in this together. We're all broken, but thank God we're all in this together, because we've got a God whose main mission is to take broken people and make them whole. His mission is to take weak people and make them strong, to take sick people and to make them healthy, and to take people who are down and out and to lift them up to rise and fly on the wings of eagles. And since we come into the presence of such a great God, would you just bow your heads and pray with me and just give ourselves to Him? Thank you, God, for knowing our story and our situation. And everybody in this room comes in here with stains of sin on their lives. Nobody gets through this life free. We all get marred with it. And yet, God, we're all in this together, and that's why we're here. We are seeking you out. We want your redemption in our lives. We want to feel your presence, God. And we just want to openly confess and admit to you, we need you. We need you more than the air we breathe. We need you more than the food we eat. God, we need you more than anything else. And today we're here to receive it. So pour the power of your Holy Spirit into each and every one of us. Help us to feel your presence. Let us walk with you. Let us rise up with you. Where we get to laugh today, God, we're going to laugh. Where we need to cry today, we're going to cry. And where we're going to do life, we're going to do life with you. God, thank you for calling us together. Thank you for your Sabbath. Thank you for this time of worship. We freely give ourselves to you and to your work that's going on inside of us. Right here, right now, we pray it in the name of Jesus Christ. We all agreed and we said together, amen.
Ushers up for the offering, and while they're coming up, will you join me in a prayer? Dear Lord, we ask that you take these tithes and offerings and bless the gift and the giver alike, that they might be used to further your kingdom. Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you, Alice. It was Karl Barth, the theologian, who said, if you cannot remember anything else about the scriptures and the teachings, just remember this: Jesus loves me, this I know, because the Bible tells me so. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Amen. Well, it is great to see everybody here today, and it is our honor and our joy and our great pleasure to celebrate the sacrament of a baptism. So I'd like to invite Trevor and Lindsay and Beckett and whoever else is coming up with you. Come on up, and family members, bring a hymnal with you. And to the congregation, if you would, look around. You'll be able to find your hymnal in the pews. We're going to go to baptismal covenant number 2 on page 39. Right, one of the things we've discovered is if you're sitting in the back pew or the very front pew, you're going to have trouble accessing a bulletin or a hymnal. So if somebody behind the front row would toss up a hymnal or two, that would be great. Or in the back row where people are sitting, because we don't have the hymnal book holders in place yet. Those are on order. So did that just make sense, or am I just babbling? I mean, how do you even explain the pew hymnal book holder? I don't even know what the official term for that is. So, all right, so page 39, I'll give you guys a moment to turn there in your hymnal. Are you guys ready to do this? I think this is a beautiful gesture and statement that you're surrounded here by your family. And of course, baptism is never done in a vacuum. It's always done in the presence of the church community and family and friends alike, because we all take a vow to help raise this child in the ways of Christ. And we take those vows serious. So thanks be to God. All right, so I don't see or hear anybody like leafing through their hymnals anymore. I think we're ready to go. So let's jump into this. Brothers and sisters in Christ, through the sacrament of baptism, we are initiated into Christ's holy church. We are incorporated into God's mighty acts of salvation and given new birth through water and the Spirit. And all this is God's gift to us, offered without a price. So Hannah, I ask you today on behalf of the church, who do we present for baptism?
Mr. Beckett Hayes McGlone.
Thank you very much. And Hannah, you have done a wonderful job as a liturgist today. Could we just pause and say thank you to Hannah? Back in the office, I said, you ready to do this? She's like, I'm ready to do it. So we're on. You are on. So, okay. So, Trevor and Lindsay, I'm going to ask just the two of you these questions that you're going to answer on behalf of your son. So on behalf of the whole church, I ask the two of you, do you renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness, reject the evil powers of this world, and repent of your sin? If so, respond with, I do. Do you accept the freedom and power that God gives you to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves? If so, respond with, I do. And do you confess Jesus Christ as your Lord and your Savior? And do you put your whole trust in his grace? And do you promise to serve him as your Lord in union with the church, which Christ is open to people of all ages, nations, and races? If so, respond with, I do. And will you nurture this child in Christ's holy church, that by your teaching and example they may be guided to accept God's grace for themselves, to profess their faith openly, and to lead a Christian life? If so, respond with, I will. Now, to the rest of the family and to the congregation, I ask you these questions. Do you, as Christ's body, the church, reaffirm both your rejection of sin and your commitment to Christ? We do. And will you nurture one another in the Christian faith and include these persons now before you in your care? With God's help, we will claim the good news and live according to the example of Christ. We will surround these persons with a community of love and forgiveness, that they may grow in their service to others. We will pray for them, that they may be true disciples who walk in the way that leads to life. And now for all of us, as we come together and celebrate a baptism, it's a time for us to reclaim our faith and state our beliefs, which is why we will go into this next part. So we'll do this with great joy and with affirmation. So let us join together in professing the Christian faith as contained in the scriptures of the Old and the New Testaments. Do you believe in God the Father? I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. And do you believe in Jesus Christ? I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead, and on the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven, is seated at the right hand of the Father, and will come again to judge the living and the dead. And do you believe in the Holy Spirit? I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, and the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. I couldn't help but while we're doing that, Beckett was up here just giving Daddy lefts and rights on the cheeks. Just so happy. I think it's wonderful. Yeah. Well, Trevor, Lindsay, Beckett, I'm going to ask just the three of you to join me up here now, if you would. And we'll have you guys go stand behind the baptismal table. He's eyeing it up. Will the Lord be with you? Let us pray. Eternal Father, when nothing existed but chaos, you swept across the dark waters and brought forth light. In the days of Noah, you saved those on the ark through water, and after the flood, you set in the clouds a rainbow. When you saw your people as slaves in Egypt, you led them to freedom through the sea, and their children you brought through the Jordan to the land which you promised. So sing to the Lord all the earth, and tell of God's mercy each day. And then God, in the fullness of time, you sent Jesus, nurtured in the water of a womb. He was baptized by John and anointed by your Spirit. He called his disciples to share in the baptism of his death and resurrection and to make disciples of all nations. Declare his works to the nations, his glory among all the people. And now, God, pour out your Holy Spirit to bless this gift of water and to those who will receive it, to wash away their sin, to clothe them in righteousness throughout their lives, that dying and being raised with Christ, they may share in his final victory. All praise to you, eternal Father, through your Son, Jesus Christ, who with you and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns forever. Amen. Amen. All right, Trevor, if I could have you come around your beautiful wife there. May I hold Mr. Beckett?
Yes, sir.
Will you let me do this? Hi, big boy. Hi, big guy. There's Mom and Dad. So, Trevor, I want to ask you as the father, what full name do you give this child?
Beckett Hayes McGlone.
Beckett Hayes McGlone. Today I baptize you in the name of the Father. You didn't like that. And of the Son, I'm fast. Yeah. And of the Holy Spirit. Oh, Beckett, oh. I caught a left hook. The Holy Spirit work within you. That's a microphone, yeah. The Holy Spirit work within you, that being born through water and the Spirit, you may be a faithful disciple of Jesus Christ all the day of your lives. And the congregation said,
amen.
Amen. Yeah, it's got a little fuzzy thing on the end, doesn't it? Yeah, let me dry you off here with your very own baptismal towel, okay? Oh, yeah. It gets better. Look, over here, over here. Over there. Wait, you changed your head there. Look there. There they are. Yes. All right. You know what? I'm going to put this in your hands. He's hanging on right now. But I want to say thank you, and if you don't mind, we're going to try and get a victory lap in. Is that okay? And as I do that, would you just welcome our newest baptized member into the church? Yeah. Gang, this is Beckett. So, he's got wet hair today. Yeah. Yeah. You're doing all right. You're doing all right. Now, Beckett, these back rows, this is just prime seating in the church. So, if you want them, you have to get here early. You have to mark them. People fight over this in this church. You know that? So, friends, this is Mr. Beckett. Can't wait to see what God has in store for his life and what's going on and how he'll grow up in the life of the church. Let me bring you up here so you can see the rest of these people. They're wonderful. Yeah. And he looks so nice today. Yeah. What do you think, Beckett? And these are prayer quilts, all right? When you're old enough, you can come back here anytime during the service. If the sermon gets dry and boring, you can just stand right up. You can come right out and tie one. So what do you say, guys? This is Beckett over here. So, yeah. We did it. We did it. Got him? All right. So with this baptismal towel, will be his forever, and it has the waters of his baptism sealed in it. And as always, we've included actual holy water in there. So it's forever sealed in this towel with his name and his date from the Huntsville United Methodist Church. And on behalf of the congregation, I'd also like to present his certificate of baptism for a keepsake. Okay? Yeah, you've done great today. So let me put that in your hands. Now, if the three of you would just come right over here. Stay up here. And if the family would turn and face the congregation. And church, we're not done just yet. So if you will look with me on page 43, we're going to offer them a commendation and a welcome. So members of the household of God, I commend these persons to your love and your care. Do all in your power to increase their faith, confirm their hope, and perfect them in love. We give thanks for all that God has already given you. And we welcome you in Christian love as members together with you in the body of Christ. And in this congregation of the United Methodist Church, we renew our covenant faithfully to participate in the ministries of the church by our prayers, our presence, our gifts, and our service, that in everything God may be glorified through Jesus Christ. And now the God of all grace, who has called us to eternal glory in Christ, establish you and strengthen you by the power of the Holy Spirit, that you may live in grace and peace together. And all God's people said, amen. Now one more thing before you celebrate this, something very special I want to tell you about Beckett today. It's his birthday. Isn't that awesome? He got baptized on his birthday. So congratulations to you guys. You have a beautiful son, a beautiful family, and little fella, this is a special, special day. You know, you just don't know what to make of the preacher guy that dunked water all over your head, do you? Yeah. Well, if you would, church, just celebrate this moment with them one more time. Thank you, guys. You may be seated. And I think at this time, I'm going to turn it over to Ashley and Jenna.
All
Why are you all saying uh-oh? Ryan, are you still calm, cool, and collected over there? You'll be happy to know that there's no science experiments this morning. Aw, man. We have a very special morning today. Not only is it Beckett's birthday and baptism day, something else is going on today. Over the next couple weeks, you guys are going to be starting something. Some of you are starting this week. What might it be? School. Are you excited? I like your excitement. That's awesome. Absolutely. So today we want to do something very, very special. We are going to have our back to school blessing. And I'm going to ask for Pastor B to come back up and join us. Jenna, I'm going to ask for your help this morning. I'm going to set this stuff right up here. All right. Would it be okay if I invited some of my other friends to come and join you guys this morning? Would that be okay?
All right, I know you guys love when I call you out, but if you are a staff member, an administrator, and a teacher, would you please come on up? As well as if you are a student, come on up. We want to pray over you this morning. Don't be shy and make me go around and point you out. Come on up, guys. A coach, what up? John, thank you for your bravery, sir. You're always one to turn to, and I value that in you. I love and value that. Come on up, guys. Don't be shy. We want to pray over you this morning. Come on up. Don't be shy. Don't be shy. You guys are awesome, awesome. If you see any teachers that might have not made their way up there, give them a little nudge, a little love nudge. All right. You guys are awesome. Are you ready for this? I am really excited about what God is about to do. All right, congregation, thanks, Tavia. I need your guys' help, okay? I have 8 prayer requests that I felt like God laid on my heart that he wanted me to echo back and pray to him as you guys start a new school year. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to read these 8 prayer requests, and then after I read them one by one, I will ask for you. If you echo that prayer, I will ask for you to respond with amen. Every time I hear somebody say amen, I'm going to go ahead and pour water into our bucket. When we're finished, what I'm going to do is put the water of our prayers in these 3 cups. I'm going to give Pastor Brian a cup, I'm going to give Jenna a cup, and I will take a cup, and we are going to bless you guys with the prayers of our congregation, so you guys know that this school year is going to be a special one, because God is going to be with you every single day, and you're not going to be alone, and he is going to, just multitude of blessings are going to be upon you this year, okay? Congregation, does that sound like a good plan? I'm going to go ahead and read these. There'll be a time for a response. I'll give you a good cue, and then you can respond with amen if you echo these prayers for our county school. So here we go, guys. Number 1. Heavenly Father, I ask that your spirit be thick amongst all of our county schools, in every classroom, every desk, the lunchroom, the staff offices, the ball fields, the choir room, everywhere, God. If you agree, congregation, would you echo my prayer with amen? Amen. You are so smart. They're explaining what echo means. Absolutely, God calls us to echo prayers. I love it. Mighty God, I ask that your protective arms be wrapped amongst all of the county schools, and no force of evil would be able to progress against them on any of their grounds. If you agree, would you echo my prayer with amen?
Amen.
God, I ask that you guide all of the administrators and staff as they lead and invest in the students and make choices that affect many. If you agree, would you echo my prayer with amen?
Amen.
Heavenly Father, I ask that whether it be a student, staff, or administrator that feels empty, alone, distraught, or broken, that your presence overwhelms and heals them in Jesus' name. If you agree, would you echo my prayer with amen?
Amen.
God, I humbly ask for each school to receive a multitude of blessings and learning amongst all of their clubs, athletics, arts, and music, so the kids can learn and experience monumental growth through you. If you agree, would you echo my prayers with amen?
Amen.
Mighty God, I ask that you bind together staff so that they can work as a team as they invest in the precious minds of our kiddos. If you agree, would you echo my prayer with amen?
Amen.
Father God, I ask that every student in this county would feel worthy, would feel safe, would feel challenged, would feel wanted, would feel loved, would feel accepted, would feel smart, would feel capable, would feel that their hearts and minds be open to learn, and more than ever this school year, discover their gifts and graces from you. If you agree, would you echo my prayer with amen? And last but not least, God, I ask with every ounce of my soul that the heart that fills the schools of this county would be drawn to you and choose to honor you, love you, and worship you in all that they do this school year. God, I pray that they would make you first, that everything they do would be for you. If you agree, would you echo my prayer with amen?
Amen.
Thank you guys so much. So at this time, if it's okay with you guys, Miss Alice is gonna play some music, and I'm gonna hand Pastor Brian and Miss Jenna a cup. We are gonna come around, and what we're gonna do, we're gonna put a cross on your forehead, and we're gonna say, God be with you. So I want you guys this school year, no matter how old you are, I know we have kindergarten all the way from administrators that have been up here for, or that have been in the schools for years. I want you to remember on your hard days that God is with you, and I pray that you feel his spirit upon you, and I pray that you feel a new energy as you start this school year to invest in these kiddos. Kiddos, I hope you remember that you're loved and all those things that we prayed over you, that you're smart and you're capable and you are worthy, okay? This is going to be a great school year, all right? Are we ready to do this, team? All right. Thanks, Miss Alice. Come on over, guys. Alright guys, thank you so much for allowing us to do that. Let's have a quick prayer and then we'll head back to junior church, okay? Thank you so much, congregation. Let's join God in prayer. God, you are so, so good. I thank you so much for your movement this morning, God. I thank you so much for your active movement, Lord. I thank you so much for Beckett, Lord, and their family, God, all the way to these oldest kiddos, God. I just thank you so much, Lord, for them, because for they are a blessing. And God, let us not forget that, Lord. And God, I just, as we pray those bold prayers, those 8 prayers, God, I pray that they would trickle out to all of our youth, God, all of the staff, all the administrators, all the teachers, God, all the coaches, Lord. God, we just lift them all up to you. God, be with us as we head back to junior church, Lord, and may the lesson come alive today. We love you so much, Jesus, and together we said, amen. All right, kiddos, head on back, guys.
Something that has occurred to me this morning, do you realize how much time we've spent in this service so far just praying? Man, to start the service, over the kids, with Beckett and the family, and now we're moving into another time of prayer. You know, the lifeblood of a congregation and the church and the kingdom is prayer. It is prayer. It is how we move things along. Prayer changes things in life. And so we are back at another time of prayer. And friends, just as a way to be conscious of your situation, whatever you're facing this morning and moving in and out, or if you've got other plans, what I want to do this morning is just, we'll go quickly around the horn. If you have any more prayer requests, you can just lift them up. We'll write those down and we'll jump into prayer. But for those of you who have filled out the prayer request forms, thank you. You can find this every Sunday morning at both locations when you come in. So with that, let me start over here. Do we have any other joys or concerns? Yes, Sherry. Dan, Brandon, Chelsea, and Branson. You're saying vacation. I'm thinking, are they in Branson, Missouri? Branson is going to Branson. I should be able to remember that. That works. That works. Thank you. All right. We'll move on around. How about in this section? Just go on. Amy? Prayers for Kenny. I saw another hand. Yes, Angie? Nick. Okay. Nick and Caitlin. Caitlin? Caitlin. Nobody is going to argue that I'm not the sharpest bulb. Just, it's, you know. So, I will keep moving on across. Down here, Trev? Absolutely it is. Karen, I'm so glad you did make it today. And just as we talk, day by day, you get stronger and stronger. And what a joy. Scriptures teach us that at a moment like this, this is your legacy. This is part of what you and God have helped create. And so drink this up today and enjoy it. Anybody? Tim? For Liz. Okay. Carolyn? Unspoken. And then, Joyce?
I just need your prayers. A month ago, I started walking more because a number of my training on walking from my house to Gans Chiropractic, which is a mile. And it's been 5 years since I did it. So I just need prayers.
Absolutely. Prayers for you, Joyce. Thank you. Kathy?
Lynn and Carol.
Okay. And let me move on across. Yes. Dean. Okay. Gary. Amanda, Anita, and Rhonda. Okay. Sharon. Jennifer. Okay. I'll work my way on across. Yes, Susie. Carson Ryan, your second grandson. Well, congratulations. All right, we'll move on back. Yes, Tina? Jacob and Caleb. Caden. Jacob and Caden. Very well. So. All right, and we'll slide. Yes, Mark? The tractor is alive in here. For those of you who don't know, Kevin Giroux and his family, when I say tractor pull, I mean they have the serious big rig. It's just phenomenal. And for the better part of a year and a half, it's been torn down, and I have watched these guys work endlessly putting this thing back together. When I say putting it back together, I'm like, I don't know the names of an engine parts, all right? But. Like the double eagle gasket barrel jam cam modifier. Did I get that? They had it in parts. And it would be kind of like me saying, well, I had some spare parts, so I built a tractor. That's what these guys do. They have put it back together, and it has been an epic journey. And tonight they go pull in Zanesville. So, and their ride is called Wild Times. So I'm hoping for a wild time, guys. And we're going to pray for you guys. It is something to be celebrated. We'll move on across. Yes, Sherry? And Guam, oh gosh. And then you know what? Let's keep Charlottesville in our prayers. I want to just take a quick moment and address this. Shortly after we arrived here, there was a gathering of Ku Klux Klan down in Bell Fountain. And what I told the congregation that day, and I was very young into this, but it is still pertinent, and it's what I'm going to tell everybody today. When it comes to those kind of gatherings and events, don't go around them. You count as one of their statistics when they say, oh, look how many people we got. You don't want to do that. And you know what? You can protest that kind of vitriol behavior by not going and then being proactive in the area of love and joy and encouragement and gathering around our brothers and sisters in Christ, regardless of race, regardless of gender. It does not matter. We will do our part apart from them to lift up the cross. Is there an amen?
Amen.
Thank you. I want to keep that in our prayers. All right, with all that, friends, let's bow our heads and let's have a word of prayer. Well, God, as we pray this morning, remind us that you always go with us. You are before us, and you are behind us. And God, the power of your Holy Spirit surrounds us and walks on each side of us. Your presence is above and below. And you are in every breath we take. And God, this morning, we recall how your scriptures teach us that you have an army of angels at the ready. And so, God, there is no doubt, and let there be no doubt in the hearts and the minds of the people gathered here, that you are our shield and our defender, our strong tower, our rock and our redeemer. So let all our fears be vanquished in this time by the power of your love and grace. And let us draw near to you, God, that you would be our strength. You would be our joy. You would be our all in all. So God, we step closer to you today, knowing that nothing separates us from your great love in Jesus Christ. We offer ourselves and this prayer to you now in the name of Jesus Christ. And we offer the prayers of our people, praying for Beckett and Trevor and Lindsay and their family. We lift up to you Dan, Brandon, Chelsea, and Branson. We pray for Kenny, Nick, and Caitlin, as well as Karen, Liz, Joyce, Lynn, and Carol. We give to you Dean, Amanda, Anita, Rhonda, and Jennifer. Oh, we give thanks for Carson Ryan. And we pray for Jacob and for Caden. We rejoice with the Jerus in wild times, and we pray safety upon them as they travel and they pull, and let your joy fill their hearts and fill their camp. And God, let your joy be the spirit that goes before them. And God, we pray for the people and the military in Guam. We pray for peace in the world. And we pray for love to prevail. And we pray for your grace and your peace over Charlottesville. And then, God, today we pray for Matt, Ethan, Travis, and Rhonda, as well as Lawrence, Dorothy, Norma, and the family of Gary Downing. We give to you Marilyn, Butch, Don, and Dustin, as well as Tina, Tanner, Tom, and Larry. We pray for Braden, Susan, Shirley, Pat, and Tom, for Bob and Trudy, Kim and Marion. God, we pray for all those men who are at the Emmaus Walk this weekend, Emmaus Walk number 71, and one of our own, Mike, is there. And I pray, God, you just rock his world. And God, we pray for Deb and Greg, Warren and Kelly, and Sophie and Mason. We lift up to you today Dale, Joe, Mary, Charles, Janet. We give to you at the foot of your cross Gavin, Brady, Roger, our marriages, Pat, Donna, and Dixie, as well as Raymond, Heather, Pat, Jackie, Rhonda, and Ray, as well as Karen, Brittany, and Dustin. And for all the unspoken prayers, God, and thank God you know them, We give them to you right now in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. And then we as your people join together and prayed aloud in one common voice. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Amen indeed. All right, well, if you have your Bible with you today, I want you to open up to the Gospel of Mark. We're going to read chapters out of chapter 4, verses 35 through 41. And just a little backstory to this. Jesus and his disciples find themselves in a boat, and a storm comes up, and they get scared. And when you get scared, you have an emotion called fear. Jesus speaks into this emotion, fear. You know, this is a series that we're wrapping up today called It's Been Said. And a lot of what I've been trying to accomplish in this series is we hear one thing about the Bible, about living the Christian life. I just want to unpack it a little bit more. And a lot of times it revolves around our own emotions and feelings. And where do they land and how do they collide with faith? And so part of that is what's going on right here today as we wrap up this series. So again, the Gospel of Mark, chapter 4, verses 35 to 41. Follow along as we read from the Word. On that day, when evening had come, he said to them, "Let us go across to the other side." And leaving the crowd behind, they took him with them in the boat, just as he was. Other boats were with him. A great windstorm arose, and the waves beat into the boat, so that the boat was already being swamped. But he was in the stern, asleep on the cushion. And they woke him up, and they said to him, "Teacher, do not care that we are perishing." He woke up and rebuked the wind and said to the sea, "Peace, be still." Then the wind ceased, and there was a dead calm. And he said to them, "Why are you afraid? Have you still no faith?" And they were filled with great awe and said to one another, "Who then is this, that even the wind and the sea obey him?" Here ends this reading, and all who hear the word of God will be blessed. Amen? All right. You're going to have to give me just a moment. I need a drink of water. That is. You got to be careful how you say those things. You know, cliches. I ought to do a series on cliches. We've had so much water in the baptism and the blessing, and it just makes me thirsty. So, all right, well, friends, for a moment, I want you to dream a dream with me. Imagine today, in this dream, in this moment, right here and right now, all your fears just evaporate. Whatever fear it is you're facing on this day, whatever fear you carry around, for a moment, just let's pretend it's gone. Whatever financial fears you might have, how am I going to make rent? How am I going to make money? What about tuition? What about the electric bill? You know what? Don't worry about it. It's gone. The fear, it's gone. About your relationships. My land, I'm so concerned about my child. They're going to make a bonehead decision. They're going to ruin the rest of their life. That fear, gone. My marriage, what's going to happen? That fear, gone. My health, I've been to the doctor. Things aren't working right. That fear, gone. You're at church on Sunday morning and you're afraid of another dry and boring sermon. Gone. Just drifted away. I said it was a dream. No reality, just a dream. Just a dream. Well, the reality is everyone in this room, as I look around, including myself, everybody in this room, you know what? We know fear. We understand fear, and we understand it with great clarity. And fear is actually a normal response and an emotion that God has given to all of us. And it's actually put in place in our system so we can help navigate life and all the dangers that come with it. Fear can be a good thing if used correctly. And, you know, I tell you that because there is actually one person in the world today who lives without fear. And just so you know, it's not Jesus. I mean, Jesus, of course, was fearless. But this is a person who is living in the here and now, not did live, crucified, resurrected, waiting for us, guiding us. That's Jesus, all right? But there is actually a person who is alive today who cannot experience fear. And I would love to tell you her name, but her doctors and her researchers will not release her name for her own protection and her own safety, because for a real life situation, she doesn't know what fear is. They call her simply SM. They don't want to reveal her name. She suffers from a condition known as, you ready for this? Urbach-Wythe disease. How many people have ever heard of it? Some nurses and stuff. Yeah, Hannah heard me talk about it. That's why Hannah knows, right? Now, in everybody's brain, there are two structures called amygdalas. And that's the sermon title, if you saw that. I spelled it as I could say it. That's how I have it in my notes. Because if I spelled it the way it was spelled, I'd be like, Amundabugalakunda. I couldn't pronounce it. So I actually went online, I YouTubed it, and like, how do you say this? It's amygdala. And if you want to know, there's two of them, about the size of an almond. If you go through your eye and through your ear, it's where they intersect. The amygdala is the center that processes fear and danger. Right? So if something's going on in your life, you're like, oh, I'm scared. Guess what? Your amygdala is at work when that happens. For this individual, SM, her disease, her disorder, means her amygdalas have calcified. Calcium has gone and hardened her amygdala. So nothing gets in and nothing gets out. And she cannot experience fear. So how's that for a disease, right? And some of you might even be thinking right now, wish I had that. I'd love to live life without fear. And you might think, yeah, that's, but you know what? No, you don't, really. You don't. You don't want this. Researchers have done some studies with her, not only her, but her family members, and they've talked, they've done research. And her oldest son recalls this story in this instance, and I wrote this down. He says, me and my brothers, we were playing in the yard one day, and Mom was outside sitting on the porch, and all of a sudden, there was this snake on the road. And this is a one-lane road we live on, and seriously, this snake was huge. It touched from one end of the yard all the way across the road into the ditch on the other side. And I was like, holy cow, that's a big snake. Well, Mom just walked over, picked it up, put it in the grass, and sent it on its way. Okay, so just a real sheer moment of honesty. Who is afraid of snakes? Okay, and like, I will climb a tree if I see a snake. I don't know why, I just freak out when I see a snake. SM, she is not afraid of snakes, not afraid of spiders. They have tried all kinds of stuff. And that's not all. SM, she has been held up at knife point and at gunpoint, physically accosted by a woman twice her size, nearly killed in an act of domestic violence, and on more than one occasion has been threatened explicitly with death. And police reports all corroborate these experiences. And the researchers make this note about her. What stands out the most is that in all of these situations where her life was in danger, she lacked any sense of desperation or urgency. None. Didn't register. Just like, okay, you got a gun pointed at me. Okay, cool. Does that make your day? Nothing. Now, researchers all agree, this woman is not stupid. She understands what can and can't kill her, but she lacks the quick, subconscious, visceral response that the rest of us feel when we are respond to danger. And they say, in some ways, she just lives a real charmed life. Everybody she meets is a good person, and allegorically speaking, every day is sunny and 75. And because of that, she lives directly in the path of danger every day, every moment. She just doesn't know it. Now, I was so fascinated by this, I decided to do a little more research on her. I just wanted to find, you know, what else is out there about the Urbach-Wythe disease? This is pretty neat, pretty fascinating. Nothing scares her. And actually, as I dug through all the research and data on it, we did find researchers did expose her to one image that she actually elicited like a blood-curdling scream. It scared the researchers. I don't know why it didn't come out originally, but they were showing her these images, and it was only one image. And when I figured out what it was, I actually went and saw it. I thought, this is bad. So I showed it to Alice, got the same response. And listen, I don't know if it's good, bad, or indifferent, but I thought, just so you can experience this, I thought, you know what, we're going to put this on the screens today. So parents, if you have children, I just want to caution you for what you're about to see. And if you must, shield your eyes. But this is the worst thing. For a woman that could not experience fear, this is what caused her to scream unheralded. So let's take a look at it, Patrick. Okay, get it off. Just get it off right now, please. This is the... Hey, Eric. How do you like me now? Yeah. So, just for the record, I made that part of it up. Nobody's scared of that. That's the biggest joke in the world. I mean, you see that, everybody's like, oh, please. So, yeah, it's good to have a little fear, but it's good to laugh. Sorry, Eric, that was done at your expense. I still love you, brother. He's making notes. I am going to get drilled today. I know I am. This is going to come back around. Oh, my goodness. I repent of my sins and ask for forgiveness from God. Amen? All right, so everybody in this room understands fear, right? Some more than others. And when you're a believer in Christ, there's actually a little tension here, because it's been said before that if you're a believer in Jesus Christ, maybe you've heard this, if you love Jesus, you shouldn't be afraid of anything. And I'm like, yeah, man, I get that. Because you know what? I'm following the one who makes all things possible. I'm following the one who can do what I can't do all by myself. I'm following the one that can do exceedingly more in my life. But you know what? At the end of the day, I look in the mirror and I realize I am human. And I got to deal with my fears. And can I just tell you something? I never knew what it was to have an anxiety attack until after I went into ministry. I spent a lot of years just coasting right through. And then when I got in ministry and started getting involved in relationships and people and the building of the kingdom and God and faith and all that, there's been a couple times, if you've ever had an anxiety attack, you know, it's like one of the worst experiences in the world. I'm not going to exaggerate on this, but there have been times I felt like, my God, my heart is going to explode. And it is beating so hard, and it's hurting because it's beating so hard. I never experienced that till I went into ministry. And here I am, a pastor. And I've been told, it's been said to me, well, you shouldn't be afraid. You're a preacher. You're a man of Christ. So there's a tension that exists right here. And this is, I think, the tension that we see in our Bible lesson here this morning from Mark. So let me recap a little bit about what's going on. They've been in ministry. Jesus and the disciples have been in ministry. And they've been working hard. And then they decide to get in a boat and they're going to head across the Sea of Galilee. And Jesus, he's tired. He's been hard at it. You know, if you've got to heal and cure and preach and all that, you get tired. So what he does is he takes his pillow, goes up to the stern of the boat, finds a comfortable position to get in, and starts taking a rest. The disciples, they go out to sea, and while out there, this horrendous windstorm kicks up and starts tossing the boat to and from. And this is bad. This is bad. The disciples are afraid, okay? They experience fear just like we do. And in the midst of all of it, the scripture said water is coming in over the boat now, and there's white capping out there. And they get so scared, they decide, you know what, we better wake the big guy up. We're going to die. So notice what they do. So let's take a look at the scripture. Let's pull this up. Simple question. They wake Jesus up. He's knocking off some Z's. They wake him up. Jesus, hey, don't you care that we're perishing? Now, I have a thought about this. Maybe the gospel writer Mark is just over-exaggerating as he writes his story, thinking, I want to add something to this. I want to make this good. Or maybe the disciples are just overreacting. They're thinking to themselves, this is just a bit uncomfortable. And anybody here ever been known to overreact? Yeah. So maybe that's the case. However, I present to you this idea. Of the 12 disciples, 4 of them were professional fishermen. If anybody is going to know what it feels like to be in a boat during a deadly storm, would it not be these disciples, at least the 4 of them? That's 1/3 of the disciples. So I'd like to think that, yes, they are correct in waking Jesus up and saying, listen, this is as bad as it gets, Jesus. We're going to die. And I think that's a more accurate description of this scripture lesson today and of the story and of the scenario that's going on. They're in a boat. Their life is at danger. They're afraid. They wake Jesus up and they say, we're going to die, Jesus. What are you going to do about it? And what Jesus does is something that I think is absolutely amazing. I never tired of seeing or hearing about this. So Jesus stands up in the stern of the boat and he looks this storm dead in the eye. And I feel like he points his finger and he says these words. Let's take a look at this. Peace, be still. You know, the gospel writer Mark adds an exclamation mark. Says, peace, be still. Says it with great authority. And then the wind ceased and there was dead calm. And just like that, boy, I tell you, the storm just went away. Just went away. But then he says to them, looks at his disciples, and he says to them straight away, why are you afraid? Why are you afraid? I've got a question for you. Have you ever heard God whisper that question in your ear? Why are you afraid? Because I have. I have. So why are you afraid? You come in and you fill this hall of worship. What fears do you bring with you today? I'm sure we all have valid responses, but something I forget, and I think most of us forget, is this simple fact. As long as I'm with God, no matter my fear, it'll all be good. It'll work out some way, somehow, someday. I don't know. I don't know how. I don't have that kind of mind. I am called to have the heart of God and to try and love. But the mind of God, that is far exceeding what I could ever contemplate. But my faith tells me, and I want faith to tell you, somehow, some way, someday, it will work out. With God, it's good. All things work to the good of those who love the Lord. Fear and fear not. It's going to come around. Now, I want to take a moment and make a little play on words, if I could. And I've been very excited about this today because this is the first time back in the new sanctuary that I'm going to use the geek board. Now, I understand that with people sitting on this side and this side, it might be hard to see. We thought we had a feature. We could hit a button back there and the camera would come up and it would be a live feed and you could see it and it would work this way. But when we hit that camera button, it doesn't work. I was afraid of that. But I've overcome my fear today. All right. I'm just going to try and explain it to you as we go. So in both secular music and in Christian music, you know, these artists get on and they sing a song about we're all to be fearless, right? You're going to be fearless. And, you know, Jasmine at Rock the Lake, her big hit right now is Fearless. She was at the lake last week and she sang. And something, she's from Mississippi. And did you know this about Jasmine? She actually won Miss Mississippi. She's a very beautiful young lady. She really is. She walked in the room like, wow, she's beautiful. It occurred to me, as a fan of Hank Williams Jr., he sings a song called All My Rowdy Friends Are Coming Over. He says in the song, And Miss Mississippi just walked through my door. And when Jasmine walked through and I knew she was Miss Mississippi, I thought, that song just became a reality. Miss Mississippi just walked through our doors. So all of you, go Google that song and you will hear that line in there. In any case, she has a huge hit right now called Fearless. One word, fearless. And when you hear a song about being fearless, or you read something about fearless, you get caught up in that moment and you think, yes, I'm going to be fearless. This great faith of Jesus Christ at work in my life makes me just this. And then the song ends, and I come back to reality, and I think to myself, nope, I still got some fears. Didn't completely evaporate. So I've been working on this, and I've been contemplating this, and I decided that instead of beating myself up for not being fearless, and if I think to myself that I do that, if I beat myself up for not being fearless, I'm going to guess that probably at least one other person in this room will beat themselves up for not being fearless, because it's been said, you're a believer, shouldn't you be fearless? I decided that, you know what my work is going to be? Here's my play on words. What I want to do is simply fear less. Can I reduce my fear levels to a manageable state? So this is my target right here. This is what I work on. Because as I told you, I never knew what an anxiety attack was till I came into ministry. And I get them much more often these days than what I ever could have imagined. And what I know is I need something to help me deal with this fear, with these anxieties. And the reality is, I would love to have a pill. I would love to have a potion, a syrup, a serum, something I could just take, a magic wand maybe, wave it, and you know what? It's just all right. But there's nothing out there that can do that. There's nothing out there that can do that. Researchers, doctors, the medical establishment all agree that in order to do this, it has to be managed in a multitude of ways. So as we think about trying to fear less in our lives, or to fear less often in our lives, I've put together an acronym using these two words, fear less. And these are ways to help manage our fears and get them back into the hands of God so we can breathe normal again and we can function in life. So let's bring this up. A little acronym I have here. What we're going to do is we're going to bust through this pretty quick. I have a scripture to go with each and every one. You might think we're getting kind of Baptist. And maybe we are. I have a lot of Baptist family, and they always get a kick out of it. And apart from that, I love the Word of God. I love the Bible. I love the fact that when my fears arise, I can turn to the Word and be anchored. And if there's anything I can give to you today, it's that. It is everything we need to overcome our fears and to fear less. I can find it in here. I am a believer, and you are a believer. Believe in this word. So, first thing we do, let's go with that. The first F, face the truth. What did Jesus do in the stern of the boat? Stood up, looked the storm right in the eye, and said, you will be peace. You will be still. He identified the fear. He spoke right into it, and it had to obey him. It's kind of like when Peter was giving him some flack, and Jesus looked at him and said, Satan, you got to get behind me. Everything has to bow to the knee of Jesus Christ. Everything. So the first thing we do is face the truth. And you remember what Jesus said in the Gospel of John? Let's take a look at that. Arrow down. You will know the truth, and the truth will make you free, and you will be free indeed. You have to identify and call out your fears. That is the first thing we have to do. All right, so let's move on to E. We have to erase the negative imprints that occur in our head. How many times do you guys waste a whole lot of energy thinking about worst case scenarios? And you just run through these images. Oh, I'm going to do this. And oh, I'm going to be homeless. And oh, I'm going to be hungry. Oh, I'm going to die. All that stuff, right? You know what? Erase those. You're walking with God. Your fears can be removed. And you can renew your mind in the hope and the grace and the promise that we have with Jesus Christ. Here's the scripture. Romans 12:2. Don't be conformed by this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your minds. Renew your mind. Renew your mind. As Christians, we are called to use not just our hearts, but also our heads. So, all right, let's move on. A, at a certain point, you're going to have to allow change to happen. Difficult deal, I know. We waste a lot of time with fear over change. But you know what? This one thing you have constant in this life, change happens. It just does. But you know what? You can put that change into God's hands. You can say, God, together we'll learn how to deal with this. We'll learn what's right, what I need to avoid, but we'll make the changes necessary. And David spent a lot of time talking about this in the book of Psalms. Look at what he says right here. The Lord is my light and salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Whom shall I be afraid? This is a guy that lived with change. From the day he walked onto the battlefield and defeated Goliath to the day he died, he faced change every day. And he just kept saying, God is my strong tower. God is my salvation. So, all right, let's go on. R, out of fearless. Go ahead, relax. You know why? Because God is God and you are not. God is the one who is ultimately in control. God, grant me the peace to know the difference between what I can change and what I can't, and then the wisdom and to accept it. That prayer of serenity. Please, God. Please. And you know what? You can breathe deep. You can count your fear down. You can force your exhaling to be longer than your inhaling. That's a physiological attack on your anxieties and on your fear. And you say, God, I just rest in your grace today. Notice what Paul says. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. So let's move on to less. We're going to fear less. The first L, love wins. Love wins. Hate doesn't. Hate's a bad deal. Love is what you want to work for. It really is. If I'm working on trying to love better, you know what? That puts me in a position where I'm overcoming fear. And what Paul say about love? It's the greatest thing. Let's look at this. Faith, hope, and love, all these abide, these three, but the greatest of these is love. It's the greatest. It's the most powerful force in the world. We just have failed to tap into it correctly. All right, E, end the feuds. You want to know why we feel so much fear? Because we spend a lot of time arguing, bickering, bantering. We waste a lot of energy and a lot of life by fighting. But what if we just decided we'll end the drama, we'll work for love, and we'll heed the words of Paul from the Bible. Let's look at this. Romans 12:18. If it is possible, so much as it depends upon you, live peaceably with all. Be at peace with each other. All right, let's go to S. Know where your salvation comes from. Salvation is rooted in the word Savior. You know what a Savior does? Saves. Saves. That's the work of Jesus in your life. He is here to save us. Look at the scripture. All who call upon the Lord will be saved. You can be saved and your fears can be vanquished. And finally, for the last S in fearless, you are now secure in your Savior. And I think Paul just says it this way. Let's look at this. He has rescued you from the power of darkness and transferred us into the kingdom of his beloved Son. Notice what he says. We're rescued. We're rescued. We're secure in the Savior. It's going to be okay. Somehow, someday, some way, by my faith in Jesus Christ, it will work out. So I'm going to keep the faith. I'm going to keep the faith. Thank you. You can jump on out of that. Listen, friends, I may not be fearless, but my work in life is constantly this. I have to learn how to fear less. And the only way I know to do it, concretely and succinctly, is to follow Jesus Christ. So I'm with him, and I hope you'll be with him too. Because what he assures us is, Our victory is secure in Him. No fears. Amen? Amen.
Let's stand as we close out our service with No Longer Slaves. Let's stand as we sing.
With a melody, you surround.
If you were here for our Watoto concert, you saw this young little girl from Uganda, Africa, stand right here on the stage and just belt that song out. And we're talking about a little girl that's been rescued from the streets, from the sex slave industry, has no parents, died from AIDS, violence, drugs, you name it. And a little girl to travel all the way over here and to stand with a microphone in front of a congregation like this and say, my fears are gone because I'm a child of God. I want each and every one of us to claim that same scriptural truth. All of us are children of the Most High God. You have been rescued. You have been saved. Yours is the freedom and the love and the grace to go forward in joy. Fears have been vanquished, and we will commit ourselves to living fear less often. You go forth now in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.